So, bright and early, 9 a.m. And I thank you all who got up this morning and weathered the storm to be here with us today. I also want to thank my colleague on the slate, Summer Shields, who is joining me here today from California, San Francisco, and Jason Ross, who is a part of our science basement team, who you'll be hearing from later. Excuse me. So let's get down to it. Right now, we are on the brink of thermonuclear World War III. If civilization is to survive, if mankind is to survive, the only option that we have at this immediate moment is to dump the current puppet in the White House, Barack Obama, now. Secondly, the slate of insane, incompetent Republican candidates who are pushing the same policy will have to go following right behind him. Today, I want to let you know that the Senate has now passed a resolution and passed a bill as of yesterday that 32 members of the Senate have signed on to, which include both Republicans and Democrats. This bill is saying that we have your back, President Obama, in launching a strike against Iran. This must be launched immediately. From Senator Lindsey Graham, he says, there are many things we can disagree on, but we found something we can unite about, and I hope the American people will take comfort in the fact that Republicans and Democrats, Democratic senators, are joining forces to stand behind President Obama on a very important issue. So, Senators Joe Lieberman, Lindsey Graham, and John McCain are telling President Obama that he will have a strong bipartisan support in Congress if he starts World War III by launching military strike on Iran. You also have the reemergence of the Dick Cheney's wife, former Vice President of the United States, Lynn Cheney, and what were called and still remain to be called the neocon war hawks, which are the emergence of Lynn Cheney, Michael Ledeen, and Karl Rove, now calling for the immediate intervention into Syria. These are the British foot soldiers now calling for an attack and an overthrow of the Assad government on Syria to happen immediately. And the Senate war party says that a war must be started, World War III, by bombing Iran, that they will be right behind Obama. This is what we're dealing with now at the present stage. It's not a joke. We are now faced with the threat of all of mankind and all of civilization. Anyone who is defending this president is completely insane. Anyone who is defending this policy of the puppet show of the Republican Party slate of candidates is completely insane. Now you ask, well, who are we supposed to vote for? What are we supposed to do? You're supposed to act like patriots, not like partisans. You're supposed to take a leaf from the book of President Franklin Roosevelt and President Abraham Lincoln, who understood that principle comes before party, and that we must fight against the interests of the imperial powers of the oligarchy that seeks to destroy mankind. That right now, our only option for survival is to immediately put forth the post-Obama presidency, which means a post-empire, which means that we must get back to the intention of the governing of a nation in accordance with the principles of the universe. Now, I don't think the principles of the universe include Republicans and Democrats joining together to obliterate all of the human species. I don't think that calling for the speeding up of the revelations, I say, these guys said revelations is coming, and so therefore we have to speed it up now, and we're gonna go ahead and obliterate billions of people on the planet. This is what we're dealing with. This is reality. This is what Mr. LaRouche has been warning about, that we are on the brink of thermonuclear war. And we are seeing this as the crisis and the collapse in the transatlantic system becomes more and more dire. That right now, there is more escalation in countries such as Greece, in all-out chaos and policies toward destruction. You have a drive toward hyperinflation. You're looking at a situation where the entirety of almost every single nation in Europe is unable to function as a sovereign nation state. The United States is heading toward the same direction as we continue to bail out the financier interests of Wall Street and London at the direction of the British Empire, directed by their puppet in the White House, Barack Obama. So we're here today because, as Ian said, we are defining what the principles of the presidency must be, what the principles of return to the sovereignty of the nation state, and the ideas that have crafted this republic, which Benjamin Franklin said, "I give you a republic if you can keep it." Right now, we're not doing such a great job of keeping it. And we must reverse that. And that is the policy that my campaign and our national slate of candidates is committed to. It is the policy that our founding fathers understood, that this is the principle of natural law in governing a society based on a commitment to the common aims of mankind and to the developments of all of the nation state and all of civilization, as well as to our own nation. And we can look at that as an expression that goes all the way back to the statesmanship and statescraft that was developed under the Platonic roots of Socrates and Plato. And a lot of us in my campaign and our young adult movement of the LaRouche youth movement, LaRouche young adult movement, have been working through this statesmanship to get an understanding of how our generation is going to provide the leadership, which is essential in understanding how the republic and how the formation of a real statesman, in which is totally devoid in our and void in our population, must come about. So you'll get an understanding from Plato in his Statesman Dialogue, as he states, that polity alone must in the highest degree be rightly established, in which the governors are found to be truly and not in appearance only scientific. A wise and good man will always govern in this manner, always attending to the advantage of his citizens. In the same manner as a pilot is watchful for the safety of the ships and the sailors. In short, prudent governors never err in any part of their conduct as long as they observe this one thing, namely, by always distributing that which is most just to the citizens in conjunction with the intellect and art to preserve them and from being worse, render them better to the utmost of their power. This is the intention which governs a nation in accordance with the principle of the universe, which is an expression of our nation's republic. It is the commitment toward human progress. This intention can be shown expressed through the principles of the credit system. This is the idea that right now, what must happen is that we have to immediately return to the Hamiltonian credit system of Article 1, Section 8 of our U.S. Constitution. The principles of the American credit system has been the antithesis to the imperial system of monetarism since its conception. The credit system must be seen as an expression of all of creative and what would be called anti-entropic development against the system of imperialism and against the system of monetarism. This is the credit system that was defined by Alexander Hamilton in our preamble to our U.S. Constitution, which is an expression of natural law, which is an expression of the commitment to progress, internal developments in research and development, in transportation, in agricultural development. It is the American system which was a product of, which was an expression of great American patriots, such as Benjamin Franklin, Alexander Hamilton, Lincoln, and President Franklin Roosevelt. The American credit system must be an expression and has continued to be an expression of the anti-entropic development of human progress. It goes against the policy of the insanity of a green genocidal policy. It has been the expression of the upward shifts in development of mankind against the imperial policy of a war drive, against the imperial policy of destruction of nation states. President Abraham Lincoln, Honest Abe, as they called him, was a student of the American system, of the Whig Party of Henry Carey, committed to the national bank and the credit policy for internal improvements. Lincoln used the credit system as the weapon for defeating the internal improvement, defeating the Confederacy with over $400 million to fund the Union Army. When Lincoln went to the New York Bank and asked for more currency, more funds to fund the Union Army against the Confederacy, he was told, "We can't help you." A close friend of his, Colonel Taylor, then said, "Well, we will use the powers of the Constitution. We will use the principles of Article 1, Section 8, and we will create the currency to do so." President Lincoln knew that defeating this empire meant using the directive of the American credit system. It meant advancing the progress toward human development, toward internal improvements. It meant organizing the Transcontinental Railway, to outflank the British, to use the powers of the land rail development as an opposition to the British Seaway development. Lincoln says, the object of the bill submitted to me, namely that of providing a small note currency during the present suspension, can be fully accomplished by authorizing the issue as part of any new emission of the United States note made necessary by the circumstances of the country, of notes of a similar character, but of less denomination than $5. Such an issue would answer all the beneficial purposes of the bill, which save a considerable amount to the Treasury in interest, would greatly facilitate payments to soldiers and other creditors of small sums, and would furnish to the people a currency of as safe as their own government. Under this plan, Lincoln is often credited with regard to the greenback. The government would use its own credit and currency for internal improvements, aside from the upfront demands of war, such things as the post roads, highways, canals, railways, and public buildings would be funded. This was the same policy of President Kennedy and his treasury bonds that were carried out to demand and extend a credit system in funding our manned space program. Now, let's take this example for a second here. The example of two great American patriots, one a Democrat, the other a Republican, both committed to the principles of the American Republic and the sovereignty of our nation state. Both not committed to partisanship. Elected 100 years apart, President Lincoln in 1860, President John F. Kennedy in 1960. Now, both understood the principle of this American Republic. They understood that there was a greater expression and a higher expression of the human mind and the human creative powers that must be put forth in the development of a nation state, as was expressed by the principles of the statesmanship of Plato and the statesmanship which governed our republic. So in 100 years, you had the development from the steam engine to the first man orbiting Earth in spaceflight. In that time, you had a rapid upshift in your development of human progress. Lincoln says, in his most favorite speech during his 1860 presidential campaign, he sets forth the basic principles, philosophical principles of the American system of political economy. And he says, this is a speech given entitled Discoveries and Inventions. All creation is a mine, and every man is a miner. The whole earth and all within it, upon it and around about it, including himself in his physical, moral, and intellectual nature, and his susceptibilities, are the finitely various leaves from which man, from the first, was to dig out his destiny. In the beginning, the mine was unopened, and the miner stood naked and knowledgeless upon it. Fish, birds, beasts, and creeping things are not miners, but feeders, and lodgers merely. Beavers build houses, but they build them in not wise differently or better now than they did 5,000 years ago. Ants and honeybees provide food, water, but just in the same way they did with Solomon, when Solomon referred the sluggard to them as patterns of prudence. Man is not the only animal who labors, but he is the only one who improves his workmanship. This improvement he effects by discoveries and inventions. His first important discovery was the fact that he was naked, and his first invention was the fig leaf apron. Now, so you had Lincoln encompassing all of human history and all of human discovery and development as a principle of the rapid upshifts that we've seen since the development of man, of Adam and Eve, the discoveries that took place at that point in time, going all the way back since hundreds of thousands of years ago, since man was first given fire. And look at the rapid pace of discovery that took place from the time of Lincoln and the development of the steam engine to the time of Kennedy, where Kennedy, in his famous Rice University speech, said that despite the striking fact that most of the scientists of the world has never known are alive and working today, despite the fact that this nation's own scientific power is doubling every 12 years in a rate of growth more than three times that of our population as a whole, despite that, the vast stretches of the unknown and the unanswered and the unfinished still are far strip our collective comprehension. No man can fully grasp how far and how fast we have come, but condense, if you will, the 50,000 years of man's recorded history in a time span of but half a century. States in these terms, we know very little about the first 40 years, except at the end of them, advanced man had learned to use the skins of animals to cover them. Then about 10 years ago, under the standard, man emerged from the caves to construct other kinds of shelter. Only 5 years ago, man learned to write and use a cart with wheels. Christianity began less than two years ago. The printing press came this year, and then less than 2 months ago, there, during this whole 50-year span, a human history, the steam engine provided a new source of power. Those who came before us made certain that this country rode the first waves of industrial revolution, the first waves of modern intervention, and the first waves of nuclear power. And this generation does not intend to founder in the backlash of the coming age of space. We mean to be a part of it. We mean to lead it. For the eyes of the world now look into space, to the moon and to the planet beyond. And we have vowed that we shall not see it governed by a hostile flag of conquest. but by a banner of freedom and peace. We have vowed that we shall not see space filled with weapons and of mass destruction, but the instruments of knowledge and understanding. So look how far we've come in the rate of human progress, from man's use of fire several hundred thousand years ago to the period of 100 years from the election of Lincoln to the election of Kennedy. We have witnessed a rapid increase of change in the process of human discovery. The developments from our discovery against the oligarchy, under the direction of Prometheus, to the understanding of a wood-burning society, the use of fire that has now unleashed great flights for mankind and leaps in progress for mankind. And you look at that in comparison with where we are today, that you are now faced with this policy of the upward shifts of mankind's development now being destroyed, now being taken backwards by the policies of the insanity of a system of imperialism, of a British oligarchy monetarist system that is pushing a policy of genocide, of a policy that says zero growth must be the policy of society and not the upward advancements of mankind. Unless we understand this, unless we understand that that is the intention of the British Empire, we will not be able to defeat this empire, who is now, as I warned at the beginning of the discussion, on the brink of pushing the civilization to World War III and to thermonuclear war. That this is their policy, to destroy the upward progress of mankind, to eliminate close to 6 billion people more from the planet. They can do that through starvation. They can do that through denying the process of fusion energy, through denying the commitment to a future progress of mankind in exploring space, through the necessity of a manned space program fully funded with the direction toward the colonization of the moon, mining helium-3 on the moon, going to Mars. That is the direction that mankind and civilization must take. We must go against the policy that is in control of both the Republicans and Republican Party candidates and Obama, the system of monetarism, of free trade, being the same system of slavery that goes against human progress, as the system of radical environmentalism that says that we must have a system of zero growth. This is what people have to understand as true statesmen. Know thy enemy, and know it well, because that's the only way you're going to defeat it. Now, our national slate of candidates are committed to defeating this British Empire and this imperial system. And the principle and weapon that we will, a principle that we would use to do that, is, as I said, a return to the Glass-Steagall banking reorganization. We must immediately wipe out the insanity of the derivatives and toxic waste, the bailout policy of trillions of dollars, and go back to a principle of commitment to development with the funding of a credit system for internal developments, infrastructure improvements, a commercial banking system, and protection of legitimate banking functions over the toxic waste that we're seeing. This was Franklin Roosevelt's policy. This is not just a bill in Congress. This is a principle that is the only principle that is currently in place that will put an end to the system of monetarism and be the first step in direction toward turning this nation and this economy around. This is a principle which has been the governing principle of our credit system since the conception of our nation, and really since the founding of the Massachusetts Bay Colony, which started the first principles of the credit system. So, as you will hear, developed throughout the proceedings of this conference, the next leap for mankind and human progress must be the commitment toward the extraterrestrial imperative, a moon-Mars colonization, with the launching pad of a fusion-based economy, which starts with the North American Water and Power Alliance and the commitment toward the collaboration with leading nation states such as Russia and China in the strategic defense of the Earth. That means the policy toward war, the policy toward mass genocide that we're seeing right now, goes against the principles of the sovereignty of our nation state, goes against the principles of the common aims of mankind that we must be seeking to accomplish. So with that, I want to end with some inspiration to all of the great American patriots sitting in this room, of a great collaborator of the and someone who really understood the need for the progress of mankind through the next leap of an extraterrestrial imperative. And this was pioneer Kraft Ehrke, a German-American visionary and rocket scientist who developed the concept of the extraterrestrial imperative. And Kraft Ehrke issues this conception of the extraterrestrial imperative against the principles of the counterculture and the Club of Rome, who say that we must have a commitment to the ideas of zero growth, of the setback of the technological advancements of man. He says, the extraterrestrial imperative is a driving force in the natural growth of terrestrial life beyond its planetary limits. As such, it is an integral part of the obviously expansionistic and growth-oriented patterns of life's evolution. This drive caused life to grow from its infinitesimal beginnings into a force that encompasses and transforms an entire planet through its biosphere. More basically, the extraterrestrial imperative, a first message, a primordial imperative, bred into the very existence of the universe, driving the evolution of matter from the simplest form. The extraterrestrial imperative is of concrete significance to us. It offers a lasting solution to the growing problem of keeping the societal, that is, the human and biological environment, cost of modern humanity's lifestyle and aspirations within acceptable limits. It provides a rational and consistent orientation in the wilderness of past and present events, Hence, a solution-oriented understanding of humanity's situation at this important crisis-prone juncture. The evolutionary road on this planet is paved with many crises. In fact, every major advance was preceded by triggered by and made possible by crisis. However, not every crisis led to an advance. The penalty of failing the test of crisis is death. So we must not fail the test of crisis. We must move mankind forward to the leaps of the extraterrestrial imperative against the policy of war and toward the commitment for human progress and the common aims of mankind. Thank you.